Goonie Burr looked around the classroom. She slid the strap of her cowhide purse from her shoulder and set the purse on the floor below the terrarium table. With her face scrunched into a quiet thinking expression, she unbuttoned her orange fur jacket and hung it on the back of the chair by her desk. Then she returned to the front of the room and faced the class. She was wearing a blue plaid skirt, a white blouse, black tights, and brown lace-up shoes. There were bright blue hair ribbons in her neatly brushed red hair. She looked ordinary. She looked dignified. She looked wise. "Out there, invisible, are a lot of stories not yet told," Goonie Bird told the class. "Absolutely true ones?" Beanie asked in a small voice. "Yes, absolutely true ones." "What are they?" asked Beanie. "Do you remember that my first story was called How Goonie Bird Got Her Name?" Goonie Bird asked. "Yes," Beanie replied. "Well, another is called How Beanie Got Her Name." "Before I was born," Beanie said, laughing, "there was a thing called an ultrasound that showed me curled up inside my mom. And I looked just like a bean. My mom said lima bean, and my daddy said no, jelly bean. And so..." "That's a fine story beginning," Goonie Bird said. "An absolutely true one. You should tell that one on Friday, Beanie." "What other invisible stories are out there?" Miss Pigeon asked. "Do you remember that my second story was about how I came from China on a flying carpet?" "Oh my, yes," Miss Pigeon said. "I had to look up China in the Atlas." "Out there, invisible and waiting," Goonie Bird said, "is a story called..." "Let me think." She closed her eyes. "Is that the title? Let me think?" Malcolm asked. "No," Goonie Bird opened her eyes. "The story is called How Kiko's Family Came to Water Tower." Kiko smiled. "Well, they started out on a ship," she said. "First, my grandmother and grandfather got on a big ship in Yokohama and went to Honolulu. They were a little scared because they had never been to America before. Miss Pigeon, you should get the Atlas out." Miss Pigeon smiled. "I will, when you tell your story, Kiko. Maybe next Wednesday?" "Okay," Kiko said. "I'll bring some pictures. And how about if I wear a kimono? That wouldn't be distracting like whiskers, would it?" "It would be lovely," Goonie Bird said. "And I could maybe carry a fan and a parasol?" Goonie Bird said gently, "That would be a little like whiskers, Kiko." "Overdoing it?" Kiko asked. "Overdoing it," Goonie Bird said. "What about me?" asked Barry. "Do I have a story?" "Of course you do," Goonie Bird told him. "You have stories called How Barry Got His Name and How Barry's Family Came to Water Tower and lots of others." Barry grinned. "Which one should I tell?" he asked. "Do you remember that my third story was about my diamond earrings?" Barry nodded. "My suggestion is that when it's your turn, Barry, you should tell an absolutely true story called When Barry Spent Every Penny He Had on Something He Wanted Really Badly." The class waited and watched Barry Tuckerman as he squinched his face up, thinking. Then he grinned. "Okay," he said, "I'll tell it. But it's really, really gross." "Oh no," said Kiko. "I hate gross." "You can cover your ears for Barry's story," Goonie Bird told her. "Wear earmuffs that day. Green ones would go nicely with your red sweater, I think." "Who else? What else?" the class called. "My fourth story was called How Goonie Bird Directed an Orchestra." Miss Pigeon suggested, "Maybe we could skip that one, Goonie Bird. I know no one in this class has ever led an orchestra." "Class?" Goonie Bird asked. "Has anyone here ever been late to school because something quite unusual happened?" Almost every hand went up. "Malcolm," Goonie Bird said, "maybe that story could be your assignment. It could be called Why Malcolm Was Late to School. It could be about the time I was asleep under my bed and my mother couldn't find me in the morning," Malcolm said. "Or the time that I dropped my toothbrush in the toilet and when I tried to get it back, I..." "Oh no," Kiko cried and covered her ears. "Don't tell it now and give it away, Malcolm," Goonie Bird said. "You work on your story and make it very suspenseful by adding a suddenly in the middle." Goonie Bird looked around the classroom. All the second graders had taken out paper and pencils. They were all writing down ideas for their stories. "And remember my last story about Catman," she reminded them. "Has anyone here ever lost a beloved pet?" Almost every hand went up again, even Miss Pigeon's. "Could that be my story, Goonie Bird?" Miss Pigeon said. "I had a parakeet named Brucey, and somehow the door to his cage was left open, and..." "Next Tuesday," Goonie Bird said. "How I Lost Brucey." and found him again, Miss Pigeon said with a happy smile. The story has a surprise ending. Mine will be How I Lost Gretchen Guinea Pig, Trisha said. Mine has a sad ending. You know what, Miss Pigeon said, standing up. It's lunchtime already. Let's skip arithmetic today, class. The students put the arithmetic books back in their desks. They reached for lunch boxes instead. Goonie Bird took out a grapefruit, a cucumber, and some dill pickles. I'm having a completely vegetarian day today, she explained. But look at this, dessert for the whole class. She held up a bulky paper bag. What is it? The children asked. Goonie Bird grinned. 63 gumballs, she said. And after I give them out, I'm going to teach you all a wonderful whirling dance called the Tarantella. Suddenly, Felicia Ann looked up from the floor. Shouldn't we all hug and kiss first? She said in a surprisingly loud voice. Thank you for suggesting that, Felicia Ann, Goonie Bird replied. Of course we should. And so they did. The end.